Hello everyone, this is Neal Davis from Digital Cloud Training. In this video, I'm going to cover some of the common questions and answers from AWS Solutions Architect interviews. So if you're going for a job role that includes AWS and Solutions Architecture, then the interviewer may well ask you questions much like these, so it's very good to be prepared. This video is supported by an article on our website in which you'll find some more questions and answers. So there's 20 questions and answers that you might get asked in an AWS Solutions Architect interview there, and you can find the link for that article in the description of this video. Okay, so let's get on with the first question. As a Solutions Architect, you're going to need to understand how to implement high availability and disaster recovery on AWS. So you may get asked a question that asks you to describe what are the features and how can you ensure high availability and disaster recovery. The first thing to respond in this is that you understand the AWS global infrastructure. So that's the core element. You need to understand regions and be able to describe what a region is. And you need to be able to understand and describe to the interviewer what an availability zone is and in which situations you might deploy resources across availability zones versus across regions. Now, in both of those cases, however you deploy your application, you need to be able to describe which services and features you will then use to ensure that the high availability is implemented correctly along with access to the application. So we're thinking about things like Amazon EC2 auto scaling. That's going to ensure that the right amount of capacity is available and that the instances are deployed across availability zones for high availability. But in front of those, you'll need something like a load balancer so that you can then direct incoming traffic across those instances. Likewise, if you split your instances or your application across different regions, now you've got to use something like DNS. So maybe Amazon Route 53 to direct incoming traffic to those different regions. And you should probably be able to describe the different types of routing policies that you might use in Route 53, like active-passive, for example, or latency-based routing. The next question is, how is AWS Direct Connect useful to an organization? Now, this might be around a hybrid cloud environment in which you've set up that private connection between an on-premises data center into the cloud. AWS really want customers to migrate into the cloud. So especially if you're interviewing with AWS themselves, they're going to specifically focus on your understanding of their services and how customers should then migrate in. Of course, also, what are the advantages of being in AWS? You've got to be 100% clear on that if you want to get if you want to actually land a job with AWS themselves. So in terms of Direct Connect, that's a private network connection versus having a VPN over the public internet, which can have latency or it can have unreliable latency, and latency that you can't control. Direct Connect offers more bandwidth, lower latencies, more consistent throughput, and it's used for connecting the public cloud to your private cloud or your on-premises data center so that you can then have that hybrid environment. From AWS's perspective, it's then a process of then migrating into the cloud. Many customers on AWS are going to have multiple accounts. So when you get more to this sort of associate level, this intermediate level, you're going to need to understand things like AWS organizations. So an interviewer might ask you what organizations is and how it helps in managing multi-account environments. So AWS organizations is a way that you can centrally manage multiple AWS accounts. You can even create accounts through AWS organizations. Then you can do things like apply policies. They're called service control policies that limit what actions, what API calls can actually be made within the accounts that are members in that organization. Another key benefit of organizations is centralized billing. So if a company has multiple accounts, they might have their production, their development, and their test accounts, for example. Or there's lots of different structures. They might break them out by business units as well, or different parts of the company. So in each of those cases, you might want to have a centralized bill. So you can centralize it using organizations. It goes up to the one account. That's where the bill gets paid. And then you can start attributing costs through things like tagging. So you can see which accounts they came from and maybe which sets of users within those accounts or what applications within those accounts through tags. So those would be the key benefits of AWS organizations. The next question is, what is the difference between an application load balancer and a network load balancer? They might even throw in a gateway load balancer as well. The old classic load balancer, very unlikely anyone's going to ask about that now, as it's very old and deprecated mainly from AWS. Still available, but no one really uses it as much, at least not for new use cases. So between the application load balancer and the network load balancer, one of the key differences is that the application load balancer operates at layer 7 of the OSI model, the Open Systems Interconnect model. So make sure you know your OSI model. It's layer 7 for the ALB. That means it can inspect the application layer. It's looking at things like the information that in the HTTP header or in the path in the URL. And then it can make routing decisions to the backend targets and target groups based on that information. So that's some of the intelligence that you get with the ALB. For the network load balancer, this is not looking at that level. It's down at layer 4, the transport layer. So it only looks at port numbers. It sees TCP and UDP traffic. It doesn't really differentiate HTTP. And it doesn't look in, it's not going to be able to inspect things like at the application level for the URL and make any kind of routing decisions based on that. So instead, it's operating at layer 4. But it's very, very fast. So it has extremely low latency, good for very high throughput applications. Lastly, the gateway load balancer, if they throw that one in there, that's very different. It is load balancing, but it's actually for load balancing across appliances. Think about network or security appliances. You might want to have an IDS, an intrusion detection system, an intrusion prevention system. You might have a next-gen firewall. And those might run on some kind of appliance, like they're running on EC2, for example. And then you can load balance across those. So that would be the gateway load balancer use case. Another question, especially if you're interviewing with AWS, would be around Amazon Aurora. They might want you to be able to describe what it is and how it is different and beneficial across compared to other relational databases. Now, to take that one back up a step, you will also need to be able to understand the difference between the relational databases and non-relational databases. So you might have, for example, RDS, Relational Database Service. That's for relational databases. And those are, for example, Aurora, and also the ones that you might know more commonly, like Microsoft SQL Server or MariaDB or MySQL. Then you've got non-relational databases. Those are, for example, Amazon DynamoDB. That's another AWS database that you really got to know if you're going for a job with AWS. Now, that's relational versus non-relational. Then we have the use case, online transaction processing or online analytics processing. So is this a transactional system? For example, it's receiving orders, or is it an analytics system where you're aggregating data, perhaps from other OLTP systems, and then running longer queries on it to try and find some customer insights? So you've got to know relational versus non-relational, OLTP versus OLAP. And then we've got Aurora. So Aurora is AWS's relational database system, and it's really positioned for them as being, you know, the gold standard of relational databases, very highly scalable, very, very high performance. They say it's much faster than MySQL or Postgres SQL, but it runs those two engines. So it's compatible with any databases that you have running on other MySQL or Postgres database servers. So you can migrate in, and then you get all the higher performance. They'll claim that it's very low cost as well. Hopefully it is for you. Of course, you have to go and have a look at the pricing models there, but certainly very high performance and scalable and lots of durability. So it has great durability across multiple availability zones. The last question I'm going to cover in this particular video is how you might optimize costs of AWS services. So an interviewer might want to gauge your understanding of cost optimization. Very, very important if you're going to be a solutions architect in the cloud to make sure that you're not spending too much. So, of course, it's about choosing the right services initially. So making sure that you have the right service for the workload, always looking at cost effectiveness along with the other requirements. You've got to think of performance, redundancy and high availability and security as well. And then you've got to balance in there and make sure that you're cost optimized. You can look at things like reserved instances for long running workloads. If you have a steady state business application, it's going to keep running indefinitely, then you should use reserved instances if it's on EC2, because that's going to significantly lower the cost. You might want to use spot instances. So if you have batch workloads that you need a large amount of compute power, short amount of time, you're kind of flexible about when it runs, then spot instances, again, can lower the cost significantly. And using auto-scaling, it applies across services, EC2, of course, with Amazon EC2 auto-scaling. But then you've got the AWS auto-scaling service, which can dynamically change the allocation of resources to a variety of services like DynamoDB as well. So that can also help you to make sure you're meeting your performance objectives whilst also being having cost control in mind as well. And then lastly, of course, there's lots of services around cost optimization and cost analysis. You can create budgets for forecasting and being alerted when you're getting close to your budget. You've got Cost Explorer, where you can go in and actually have a look at a breakdown at an itemized level of all your costs. So those are just a few AWS interview questions. If you go to the article on our website, you can learn much more there. You can also learn more about our bootcamp program. So if you're serious about coming into the AWS cloud industry and developing a high-paying cloud career, we have a live training program where you get to be taught by some of the industry experts who've been working in this industry for many years, multiple decades for many of them, and career coaches who know how to set you up for success and make sure that you're doing all the right things so you get noticed in the crowd when there's many people trying to apply for a job. We want to make sure that you can get through to the front and get the best chance of placing into that job role. So go to our website, have a look. You can find out more information about our bootcamp program, as well as find some more AWS interview questions.